The car headed further into the built-up areas of town towards the city. Stark wondered about the river. The Thames was a notorious repository for bodies, weighed down and made to vanish. But it still seemed strange to use a very noticeable car like a crimson Rolls-Royce for such a purpose. If a body was discovered and witnesses questioned, someone would surely remember it. So where was he being taken, and why? The answer dawned as the car drove along Fleet Street and then, as it reached the offices of the Daily Target, turned off the main street into a narrow lane and then down a ramp that led beneath the building into an underground car park. So, Lord Glenavon wasn't taking Stark's refusal to talk to his newspaper lightly. The car pulled up, and the two men in the back with Stark gestured with their guns for him to get out. He did so, and came face to face with the man from the front passenger seat. Flanked tightly on either side, Stark was marched towards a lift door, the third man following. So far, nothing offered any chance of escape. The lift door was opened, and Stark and the three men crammed into the tight space. Buttons were pressed, hidden levers clanked, and the lift rode upwards. When it stopped, Stark was pushed out and marched across a short hallway into a large room. A window with a panoramic view over London ran the whole length of one wall. Two men were standing by the window, and they turned as Stark was pushed towards them. One was Edgar Cavendish, the other Stark recognised from photographs as Lord Glenavon.
"Welcome, Chief Inspector," said Glenavon. "I'm glad you could join us. Please accept my condolences on the death of your late father."
"I'll be missed," said Stark curtly.
"No, you won't," said Cavendish. "A note has gone to your home saying you've had to go out on a case." "Please, sit down," said Glenavon. "There's no reason we shouldn't be comfortable while we talk."